story with Sharon Dodua Otu, our guest who has come all the way from Berlin to be with us, and we're so grateful that she has made that very long trip. I'm going to tell you a little bit about her, but also, first before I forget, I would really like to thank our co-sponsors, Department of German Studies, the Department of French and Italian, and the Program in Africana Studies for their support in putting together the last few days of events with Sharon Dodua Otu. And I'd also like to thank Sam Tavey, the events coordinator from College of Humanities, for helping us put together this evening. I'm so happy that this was able to come together, and it started all out with a tweet. I'm just going to say this. I've never believed in Twitter before, before I decided to tweet Sharon Dodua Otu and ask her about the story. And that's one of the reasons why we're here. Sharon Otu is the winner of this year's Ingeborg Bachmann Prize for Literature in the German language. It is not just a big deal, it's the big deal in Germany, Austria, and German language literature. It's the biggest it gets. She won that prize this year in July 2016 for the short story that you're going to be hearing this evening, which is called Herr Grütbe setzt sich hin. And so this is a really big deal for us to have an Ingeborg Bachmann Prize winner here in Tucson with us. I believe it's the first time ever. Maybe not the last. So I should share with you before we get started a couple of books by Sharon Dodua Otu. This is called Die Dinge, die ich denke, während ich höflich lächle, or The Things I'm Thinking While I Smile Politely. This book, I'm reading it now in English, and it's absolutely beautiful. This book is called Synchronicity. This is a novel called Synchronicity. And this is Winter Shorts, which is an edited collection of short stories. They're all available on a sliding scale between $10 and $15 after the reading. I'll be selling them so that you can talk to Sharon, and so I'll be doing the money part. But I can really recommend these wonderful books to you. They are nourishing, wonderful contributions to my life. Let's see, what else? I should mention that Sharon was born in London, and one of the extraordinary and wonderful things about her Ingeborg Bachmann Prize win is that it's not very very frequent that someone born in London ends up winning the German Language Literature Prize. So it's quite an extraordinary itinerary that has brought Sharon to this moment. She has lived in Berlin, Germany, since 2006, and earlier than that, she moved from London to Germany, I think to Hannover, to be an au pair. And so for many of us who have studied a foreign language and thought about what is our future in that foreign language, Sharon is an amazing model of what is possible. In moving from language to language, from place to place, and so before I start to gush, I should say something about the story that we're going to be reading this evening together, which is, as I said, called Herr Grütbe setzt sich hin, Herr Grütbe sits down. We're going to be performing it bilingually for you, so there'll be a little bit of German, then a little bit of English, and a little bit of German, and then on top of each other, so that should be fun. I'm excited about that. And it's a story about switching perspectives, about the ability to think of the world from various perspectives. And just as you might be getting comfortable in the story as you're listening to us, things start to change. So be ready for that. Right when you think things are becoming normal, they're suddenly not anymore. Is that an accurate?
Yeah.
So I think we'll be performing and reading for about 45 minutes, and then we'll have plenty of time for discussion and questions, and for you to come up to me and and get some of these lovely books. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
All right, I'm going to open my water. Hagutuk Sits Down by Sharon Dodogotu, translated by Patrick Ploschnitsky and Judith Menzel.
Herr Grötter setzt sich hin, von Sharon Dodogotu.
Please ensure that you are sitting in your seat comfortably. It should neither be too warm nor too cold. You may scratch your elbow if you feel to do so. Should you need to cough or sneeze, now would be the appropriate time. You should hold a printed copy of the story in your right hand. Slowly raise your left hand and cover your left eye. You may now begin to read.
Bitte sorgen Sie dafür, dass Sie bequem auf Ihrem Platz sitzen. Es sollte Ihnen weder zu heiß noch zu kalt sein. Kratzen Sie sich ruhig am linken Ellenbogen, wenn Ihnen danach ist. Wenn Sie husten oder niesen müssen, wäre jetzt die angemessene Zeit dafür. Die Geschichte sollten Sie ausgedrückt in Ihrer rechten Hand halten. Heben Sie langsam Ihre linke Hand und halten Sie schließlich damit Ihr linkes Auge zu. Nun können Sie anfangen zu lesen.
He was certain. That's why any further discussion was absolutely unnecessary. He just knew he was right. Lips firmly pressed together, he came to a stop next to the stove, continued to look smugly at his watch, and decided to tolerate no more nonsense. Which is why Frau Kotrup sighed.
Wusste es genau, deswegen war jegliche weitere Diskussion vollkommen unnötig. Hatte ganz einfach recht. Die Lippen fest zusammengepresst, blieb neben dem Herd stehen, schaute mit leicht hochgezogenen Augenbrauen weiter selbstgefällig auf die Armbanduhr und beschloss, keinen Unsinn mehr zu dulden. Also seufzte Frau Kotrup.
At the same time, she removed one egg from the pot, then the second, and with just a couple of expert moves, rinsed them both off in cold water. By now, the silence in the kitchen was as sharp as knives. The bubbling of the boiling water aside, the only thing audible was the two people breathing. Person number two, Frau Grotrup, groaned multiple times, but very quietly and almost imperceptibly. Person number one was Herr Grotrup. He nodded as he breathed through his nose, deep in, deep out.
Gleichzeitig nahm sie ein Ei aus dem Topf, dann das zweite und schreckte beide mit ein paar gekonnten Handgriffen ab. Die Stille in der Küche war inzwischen messerscharf. Abgesehen von dem Blubbern des kochenden Wassers war nur noch das Atmen zweier Menschen zu hören. Person Nummer zwei, Frau Grotrup, stöhnte mehrmals, aber ganz leise, fast unabhängig. Person Nummer 1 war Herr Grotrup. Nickte, während durch die Nase atmete, tief ein, tief aus.
Helmut Grotrup, 78 years old, 91 kilograms, exactly 6 feet tall, was a German engineer, rocket specialist, retired 9 years prior, inventor and chess genius. Regrettably, he had been forced to give up his weekend cycling tours because of his bad knee. In the meantime, he had come to enjoy his new status as a routine Sunday driver. Right after church, he'd like to chauffeur his wife and his plastic nodding dog along the main streets for hours on end, proudly singing German hiking songs while her hand rested gently on his thigh. He delighted in the punctuality of the Regionalbahn trains, in the shady spots in his little area of the shared garden in high summer, and in the small trusty bottle of Underberg bitters at day's end. Less pleasing to him jaywalking youths, the anglicization of the genitive case, and presumptuously jumping straight to first name basis. Were someone to call him a Christian in his presence, he would have had to correct them with all due respect. He was a committed Protestant. Were someone to refer to him as a cis man, no doubt he would have frowned in general confusion. And if they had called him white, he would either regard this as a synonym for German or wonder if it was to be taken as an insult. Or both, the question of his disposition of the day.
Helmut Grötu, 78 Jahre alt, 91 Kilogramm, 1 Meter 83, war deutscher Ingenieur, Raketenspezialist seit 9 Jahren pensioniert, Erfinder und Schachgenie. Die wochenendlichen Radtouren musste er bedauerlicherweise vor 2 Jahren sein lassen, weil er es mit dem Knie hatte. Inzwischen genoss er seinen neuen Status als regelmäßiger Sonntagsfahrer. Gleich nach der Kirche kutschierte er gerne samt Frau und Wackeldackel stundenlang die Hauptstraßen entlang, im Frühtau zu Berge singend, während ihre Hand auf seinem Oberschenkel lag. Er freute sich über die Pünktlichkeit der Regionalbahn, die schattigen Stellen in seinem Schrebergarten während des Hochsommers und die kleine, verlässliche Flasche Unterberg am Ende des Tages. Er fand bei rot über die Ampel gehende Jugendliche das Aggressieren des Genitivs und das einfach drauf losduzen weh. Wenn jemand ihn in seiner Gegenwart als Christ bezeichnet hätte, hätte er mit Verlaub korrigiert. Er war überzeugter Protestant. Wenn jemand ihn allerdings als Cis-Mann bezeichnet hätte, hätte er vor lauter Irritation bestimmt die Augen zusammengekniffen. Und wenn jemand ihn als weiß bezeichnet hätte, hätte er dies entweder als Synonym für Deutsch aufgefasst oder sich gefragt, ob dies als Beleidigung zu verstehen war. Oder beides. Eine Frage der Tagesverfassung.
His morning routine, which had essentially remained the same over the years, would soon come to a close today with the beginning of their breakfast, or to be more precise, with the eating of the egg. Usually it was she, Frau Grötrup, who was in charge of the kitchen, while his tasks were to get the mail, to ascertain the outside temperature, and to polish the shoes. He found this division of things quite fitting. But lately, his wife had permitted herself a few small lapses, which meant that he'd had to supervise everything meticulously. She just wasn't as vigilant with things as he was. And so it came to be that he built in an extra 8 minutes each morning so that he could also briefly stop by the stove. This had recently proven itself to be quite advantageous.
Seine über die Jahre im Wesentlichen gleich gebliebene Morgenroutine würde heute bald mit Beginn des gemeinsamen Frühstücks, genauer gesagt mit dem Essen des Eis, enden. Normalerweise war sie, Frau Grötrup, die Chefin der Küche und seine Aufgaben waren es, die Post hereinzuholen, die Außentemperatur zu kontrollieren und die Schuhe zu putzen. Die Aufteilung fand er eigentlich passend. Doch in letzter Zeit erlaubte sich seine Ehefrau einige kleine Fehltritte, die dazu führten, dass er nun alles haargenau kontrollieren musste. Sie war einfach nicht so konzentriert bei der Sache wie er. Und so kam es, dass er jeden Morgen ungefähr 8 Minuten zusätzlich einplante, um auch kurz am Herd stehen zu bleiben. Das hatte sich in letzter Zeit als sehr gewinnbringend herausgestellt.
Now though, he could finally sit down at the breakfast table as everything seemed to be in order. Hands in his pants pockets, Herr Grötrup ambled from the kitchen back into the dining room, collected and content. For a minute, he had actually considered supporting Frau Grötrup even more by carrying the tray, as she was certainly not as strong as he. He decided against it, though, seeing as how he really had done quite enough, standing by her side and advising her throughout the morning.
Jetzt konnte er sich aber endlich an den Frühstückstisch setzen, da anscheinend alles in Ordnung war. Mit den Händen in den Hosentaschen schlenderte Herr Grötrup gefasst und zufrieden aus der Küche zurück ins Esszimmer. Er hatte zwar kurz überlegt, Frau Grötrup, die gewiss nicht so stark war wie er, auch noch mit dem Tragen des Tabletts zu unterstützen, entschied sich aber dagegen, da er ihr heute Morgen wirklich genug Beratung zur Seite gestanden hatte.
Frau Grötrup followed Herr Grötrup. On a small tray she balanced the butter, the milk, the gouda, three tomatoes, the orange juice freshly squeezed, the silverware, two glasses, two coffee cups, and the eggs, of course. Bread, salt, and pepper were already there on the table. She would have to go back into the kitchen one more time for the coffee pot, the plates, and the sugar. Her hands were quivering as the tray really was a bit heavy for her. But ever since he had taken to laying out his clothes the evening before, Frau Grötrup very much preferred to bring the breakfast to the table on her own in the mornings.
Frau Grötrup ging hinter Herrn Grötrup her. Auf einem kleinen Tablett balancierte sie dabei die Butter, die Milch, den Gouda, drei Tomaten, den Orangensaft frisch gepresst, das Besteck, zwei Gläser, zwei Kaffeetassen und eben die Eier. Brot, Salz und Pfeffer standen bereits auf dem Tisch. Sie würde für die Kaffeekanne, die Teller und den Zucker noch einmal zurück in die Küche gehen müssen. Ihre Hände zitterten, weil das Tablett eigentlich ein bisschen zu schwer für sie war. Doch, seitdem er angefangen hatte, schon abends seine Kleidung zurechtzulegen, war es morgens Frau Grötrup viel lieber, allein das Frühstück zum Tisch zu bringen.
There was a little rattling as she put the tray on the table, but nothing fell over. More than once in her life, she had been warned to pay special attention to that. Still, Herr Grötrup eyed the whole affair critically, which might have made Frau Grötrup even more shaky. But since she was also especially looking forward to her breakfast egg this morning, only for other reasons than those of Herr Grötrup, she didn't notice it. After she'd emptied the tray, she set off once more.
Es klapperte ein wenig, als sie das Tablett auf den Tisch stellte, dennoch kippte nichts um. Sie war in ihrem Leben mehr als einmal ermahnt worden, extra darauf zu achten. Herr Grötrup betrachtete trotzdem das ganze Geschehen kritisch. Was Frau Grötrup natürlich noch zittriger hätte machen können, weil sie sich aber auch auf das Frühstücksei heute Morgen besonders freute, allein aus anderen Gründen als Herr Grötrup, fiel es ihr nicht auf. Nachdem sie das Tablett leergeräumt hatte, lief sie noch einmal los.
Frau Grötrup entered the dining room a second time, now with the remaining things. Today's issue of the Merkur had meanwhile been spread out on the table too. Herr Grötrup was reading his newspaper with visibly immense joy about the long-awaited rebuilding of the Munich City Library. There was a pleasant scent of hot coffee and fresh baked bread. Frau Grötrup had no interest in newspapers or city libraries. Had Herr Grötrup given it any thought, he would have come to the realization that he actually no longer had any idea what interested her.
Frau Grötrup kam ein zweites Mal ins Esszimmer, jetzt mit den restlichen Sachen. Inzwischen lag auch die heutige Ausgabe des Merkurs auf dem Tisch. Herr Grötrup las mit sichtlich großer Freude vom lang ersehnten Umbau der Münchner Stadtbibliothek. Es duftete angenehm nach heißem Kaffee und frisch gebackenem Brot. Frau Grötrup interessierte sich weder für Zeitungen noch Stadtbibliotheken. Hätte Herr Grötrup darüber nachgedacht, hätte er festgestellt, dass er überhaupt nicht mehr wusste, wofür sie sich interessierte.
She put the plates on the table, one in front of him, one in front of herself, before she too finally sat down. Exactly in that moment, the bells struck 7:30, as though it had all been choreographed to perfection. As Frau Grötrup put the eggs into the egg cups and placed one on his plate and one on her plate, Herr Grötrup reached for his teaspoon without looking up. The library would most likely be ready right on time for next spring. Even the budget appeared to have been realistically calculated this time around. Moreover, he had come to the conclusion, quite incidentally, that his egg had been rinsed and had been cooled down in just the right way today. It just felt comfortably warm. Herr Grutrück was perfectly content with his...
Sie stellte Teller auf den Tisch, einen vor ihn, einen vor sich, bevor sie sich dann endlich auch hinsetzte. Genau in dem Moment schlugen die Glocken 7.30 Uhr, als wäre alles perfekt inszeniert. Während Frau Grutrück die Eier in die Eierbecher stellte und einen auf seinem Teller, einen auf ihrem Teller platzierte, griff Herr Grutrück, ohne aufzusehen, nach einem Eierlöffel. Die Bibliothek würde wohl pünktlich zum nächsten Frühjahr fertig werden. Auch das Budget schien diesmal realistisch kalkuliert worden zu sein. Außerdem stellte er nebenbei fest, war heute sein Ei richtig abgeschreckt worden, denn es fühlte sich einfach angenehm warm an. Herr Grötrup war völlig zufrieden mit seinem...
What in earth is this?
Das?
Thank goodness Frau Grötrup didn't drop anything. Because her husband yelled just as she was about to start pouring him some coffee and was startled.
Gott sei Dank ist Frau Grutrück nichts aus der Hand gefallen, doch als er schrie, war sie dabei gewesen, ihrem Mann Kaffee einzugießen und erschrak.
Helmut! A tiny drop of coffee seeped into the tablecloth, upsetting. Fortunately, she was able to hide the brown spot very well with the sugar bowl. Today was white laundry day anyway. Hagrid, however, now had a few yellow speckles of various sizes on his tie, a fact that, put mildly, brought him great discontentment. After he peeled off the tip of the egg and sprinkled some salt and pepper onto it, Hagrid, still in the midst of his reading, had endeavored to pleasurably spoon it out. And he would have done this if the egg hadn't, in an entirely unpredictable manner, splattered all over him. In other words,
ein Tröpfchen Kaffee sickerte ärgerlicherweise in die Tischdecke. Zum Glück konnte sie aber den braunen Fleck gut mit der Zuckerdose verstecken. Weißwäsche war sowieso heute dran. Herr Grötrup hingegen hatte einige gelbe Kleckse unterschiedlicher Größe auf seiner Krawatte, eine Tatsache, die ihn, gelinde gesagt, höchst unzufrieden machte. Nachdem er die Spitze des Eis gepellt und ein wenig Salz und Pfeffer darüber gestreut hatte, wollte Herr Grötrup, noch während er las, es genüsslich auslöffeln. Er hätte es auch, wenn ihn das Ei nur nicht auf absolut unvorhersehbare Art und Weise angespritzt hätte. Mit anderen Worten,
the egg was still soft.
Weich.
How is that even possible? He dropped the egg instantly onto his plate and sought to liberate his tie from the sticky yellow chaos using his freshly ironed cotton napkin. Vexed, Herr Grutrück looked upward. Frau Grutrück was eating her egg placidly. Still, it was easy to tell she was now struggling not to let out a snort. It wasn't anything in the carriage of her body that signaled this, as her hands were still calm. Though she took the precaution of dabbing around her mouth with her napkin, all the while her lips remained quiet. But Herr Grutrück could see exactly how Schadenfreude scurried across her face, how it found a place to rest in her eyes.
Wie konnte das nur sein? Er ließ das Ei augenblicklich auf seinen Teller fallen und befreite seine Krawatte von dem gelben, klebrigen Chaos mit seiner frisch gebügelten Baumwollserviette. Verärgert schaute Herr Grötrup hoch. Frau Grötrup aß ihr Ei in Ruhe. Es war ihr anzusehen, dass sie sich anstrengte, Licht loszupusten. Die Anzeichen dafür waren nicht an ihrer Körperhaltung festzumachen, denn ihre Hände waren immer noch ruhig. Sie tupfte zwar vorsichtig ihren Mund mit ihrer Serviette ab, dabei waren ihre Lippen still. Doch Herr Grötrup konnte genau sehen, wie Schadenfreude über ihr Gesicht huschte und einen Ort zum Ausruhen in ihren Augen fand.
That was 7.5 minutes on the dot, wasn't it? Herr Grutrück sounded less confident than he would have liked to.
Das waren doch auf die Sekunde 7.5 Minuten, oder etwa nicht? Herr Grutrück klang weniger selbstsicher, als er wollte.
Frau Grutrück didn't respond right away, confounded. Herr Grutrück looked down at his egg again. It was in point of fact still soft, even though he had abided by all the rules of steps. Concluding from the small black H written on his egg in felt tip marker, he had already determined unequivocally that the egg could not have been switched by mistake, and it could not possibly have been due to low air pressure in the kitchen either. Perhaps the fridge had been colder this morning than usual? He would confirm that right away. His wife's voice hacked into his calculations and equations like a chainsaw.
Frau Grötrup reagierte zunächst nicht. Irritiert sah Herr Grötrup noch einmal herunter zum Ei. Es war tatsächlich immer noch weich. Dabei hatte er doch alle Vorschriften, Schritte eingehalten. An dem kleinen, mit einem schwarzen Edding geschriebenen H auf seinem Ei hatte er bereits zweifelsfrei festgestellt, dass die Eier nicht versehentlich vertauscht worden waren. Und dann einen womöglich niedrigeren Luftdruck in der Küche konnte es ja auch nicht. Vielleicht war der Kühlschrank heute Morgen viel kälter gewesen als sonst. Das würde er gleich kontrollieren. Wie eine Kettensäge drang die Stimme seiner Frau in seine Rechnungen und Gleichungen ein.
I'll make you another egg, yeah? All he could do was nod. Frau Grötrup blinked a few times. Both were silent. In the next moment, they both stood up. She, because she quite dreadfully, quite urgently, and above all, quite alone and behind a closed door, needed to cough. He, because the only thing he could think about was checking on the temperature in the refrigerator. It was only now that he noticed that her hair had in fact become much grayer than his.
Konnte nur nicken. Frau Grötrup blinzelte mehrmals, beide Schritte. Im nächsten Moment standen sie gleichzeitig auf. Sie war sie ganz schrecklich, ganz dringend und vor allem ganz allein hinter geschlossener Tür husten musste. Und er, weil er nur noch im Kopf hatte, nach der Temperatur des Kühlschranks zu schauen. Erst jetzt sah er, dass ihre Haare wirklich viel grauer als seine waren.
Helmut, I'll take care of it, she assured him. You don't need to come along. And without wasting another word, she took off. They found themselves alone in the dining room, Herr Grötrup, and the egg that dared to still be soft.
Helmut, ich mach das schon, versicherte ihn Frau Grötrup. Brauchst nicht mitkommen. Und ohne ein weiteres Wort zu verlieren, ging sie fort. Also waren die beiden allein im Esszimmer, Herr Grötrup, und das Ei, das sich traute, noch weich zu sein. Please continue to remain seated. The story is not over yet. Take your left hand away from your head and pass the story from your right hand to your left. Next, slowly raise your right hand to your head and cover your right eye. You may now continue to read.
Bleiben Sie bitte weiterhin sitzen. Die Geschichte ist noch nicht zu Ende. Nehmen Sie Ihre linke Hand vom Kopf weg und reichen Sie die Geschichte von der rechten Hand zur linken. Heben Sie als nächstes Ihre rechte Hand langsam zum Kopf und halten Sie damit Ihr rechtes Auge zu. Sie können jetzt weiterlesen.
Sometimes I wake up
und denke, heute bin ich ein Ei.
Admittedly, it doesn't happen to me that often. Who wants to be an egg, after all? Not really round, not really stable, not really attractive. Much more often I thought in the morning, today I'm going to be creme brulee, or a winning lottery ticket, or a sundress. These things bring people joy, at least. But today I just wanted to pass as something trivial. No big fuss, above all, no chaos. Just be an egg. Stay on the safe side. I hadn't counted on actually being boiled this time. The other times when I've chosen eggness, I just stayed in the fridge the whole day. But yesterday, Grötrup's only had one egg left, and Irmi remembered this so late in the evening that she didn't have time to go and buy some.
Zugegeben, das passiert mir nicht oft. Wer will schon ein Ei sein? Nicht wirklich rund, nicht wirklich stabil. Nicht wirklich attraktiv. Ich habe viel öfter morgens gedacht, heute bin ich ein Crème Brûlée oder ein Lottogewinn oder ein Sonnenaufgang. Wenigstens haben die Menschen Freude daran. Aber heute wollte ich einfach als etwas Belangloses durchgehen. Keine große Aufregung. Vor allem kein Chaos verursachen. Einfach ein Ei sein. Auf der sicheren Seite bleiben. Ich habe nicht damit gerechnet, dass ich diesmal wirklich gekocht würde. Sonst, wenn ich das Eisern gewählt habe, bin ich immer den ganzen Tag einfach im Kühlschrank geblieben. Grütrüps hatten gestern aber nur noch ein Ei zu Hause und das fiel Irmi leider abends so spät ein, dass ihr keine Zeit blieb, noch schnell eins einkaufen zu gehen.
By the way, nobody among the living calls her Irmi. The last time she heard that name, she was still living at her parents' house, and she had just secretly started dating her boyfriend at the time. He'd called her that, and so had her grandma. Since his retirement, Irmi's husband had only ever called her Mutti, and even though they didn't have any children, if this had at least been meant as a term of endearment.
Irmi wird sie übrigens nie von Lebenden genannt. Das letzte Mal, als sie diesen Namen hörte, wohnte sie noch bei ihren Eltern und hatte gerade angefangen, sich heimlich mit ihrem damaligen Freund zu treffen. Er hat sie so genannt und ihre Oma auch. Seit seiner Pensionierung wurde Irmi von ihrem Mann nur noch Mutti genannt, obwohl sie keine Kinder hatten. Wenn es wenigstens liebevoll gemeint gewesen wäre.
Anyway, as she was praying in the early morning, Irmi remembered that Ada would come today. On Mondays and Thursdays, this woman came to clean the Grotrup's house, and on these particular days, she would begin so early that even I'm not sure if Irmi's husband knows that there is an Ada at all. Whatever the case, two eggs were indeed brought by Ada, wrapped in plenty of paper towels. Of course, normally, one egg would have been absolutely sufficient. But Ada had an inkling about what would happen at the breakfast table, and that's how I made it to the Grotrups today.
Wie es auch sei, während sie frühmorgens betete, erinnerte sich Irmi, dass Ada heute kommen würde. Diese Frau putzte immer montags und donnerstags bei den Grotrups und fing an, den jeweiligen Tagen so früh an, dass es selbst mir nicht klar ist, ob Irmis Mann überhaupt weiß, dass es einen Ada gibt. Zwei Eier wurden jedenfalls eingewickelt in reichliche Mengen an Küchenrolle von Adam mitgebracht. Ja, normalerweise wäre ein Ei völlig ausreichend gewesen. Ada hatte aber irgendwie bereits eine Vorahnung davon, was am Frühstückstisch passieren würde, und so bin ich heute zu den Grotrups gelangt.
I rarely judge the people I encounter. I always try to regard them in a way that lets me get at their true core. I've become pretty good at that, especially in Germany. But even beings like me have bad days now and again. All I wanted was to chill in the fridge, you know. And the way Irmi's husband was acting, I thought, I need to provoke that one a little.
Ich bilde mir selten ein Urteil über die Menschen, denen ich begegne. Ich versuche sie immer so zu betrachten, dass ich an ihren wahren Herrn rankommen. Das kann ich inzwischen ganz gut, besonders in Deutschland. Aber selbst Wesen wie ich haben manchmal schlechte Tage. Ich wollte ja einfach im Kühlschrank chillen. Und so, wie Irmis Mann drauf war, habe ich gedacht, den muss ich ein wenig provozieren.
So I decided I wouldn't become hard-boiled.
Also beschloss ich, nicht hart zu werden.
My reasons for this decision were the kind of thing Irmi's husband would never have been able to understand. This isn't surprising. Already in the first great allocation, he'd been presented with nothing but his own kind of human body and the life of a mortal. This, by the way, is not meant to sound disparaging. I mean, I haven't even managed to achieve that much. Irmi had fared a little better than her husband back then, though. It had always been blessedly irrelevant to her whether the egg was boiled for 7 minutes or 17. It wasn't even a question of whether her husband wanted the egg in one specific way or another. For him, something so ambiguous as very firm egg white and medium soft egg yolk, the kind that Irmi actually liked, was simply unbearable. A breakfast egg was to be hard-boiled, period. Still, it was clear to her that the argument this morning was not actually about the egg, nor about the waste of water that ensues when an egg is boiled too long, or about the exploding electric bill. And that's why at some point, Amy tuned out during her husband's lecture and just took the egg out of the water as requested. It may have come across as resignation. It was, in fact, a pragmatic, passionless act. She feared that the blunt but growing feeling in her temples would later develop into a migraine, which would have been frustrating since she'd wanted to finally go shopping for an egg boiler this afternoon. It wasn't worth all this pointless discussion.
Meine Gründe für diese Entscheidung hätte Irmis Mann niemals nachvollziehen können. Das ist nicht verwunderlich, denn er hatte ja auch schließlich seine Art von Menschenkörper und ein sterbliches Leben bei der ersten großen Verteilung geschenkt bekommen. Das ist übrigens überhaupt nicht abfällig gemeint. Ich habe ja nicht mal das geschafft. Irmi schnitt damals etwas besser ab als ihr Mann. Somit war es ihr tatsächlich herzlich egal, ob das Ei 7 oder 17 Minuten kochte. Es ging nicht einmal darum, dass ihr Mann das Ei irgendwie besonders haben wollte. So etwas Uneindeutiges wie sehr festes Eiweiß und mittelweiches Eigelb, wie Irmi das eigentlich mag, fand er schlicht unausstehlich. Das Frühstücksei sollte hart sein. Punkt. Gleichzeitig war es ihr allerdings klar, dass es bei dem Streit heute Morgen nicht wirklich um das Ei ging oder um die Wasserverschwendung, die damit einhergeht, wenn ein Ei zu lange kocht. Oder das unnötige in die Höhe treiben der Stromrechnung. Und deswegen schaltete Irmi während des Vortrags ihres Mannes innerlich irgendwann ab und nahm sein Ei einfach wie gewünscht aus dem Wasser. Es wirkte vielleicht wie Resignation. Tatsächlich war es aber ein leidenschaftloser, pragmatischer Akt. Sie hatte Angst, dass das wachsende, stumpfe Gefühl in den Schläfen sich später zur Migräne entwickeln könnte, was ärgerlich gewesen wäre, weil sie heute Nachmittag endlich nach einem Eierkocher schauen wollte. Die sinnlose Diskussion war die Sache nicht wert.
Amy would theoretically have had the option to get a detailed description for my decision from Ada. She squandered her chance by acquiescing to the thought that, with her new reading glasses, she was simply better able to read the oven clock than her husband could. Besides, Amy spoke very little with Ada. She didn't even know that Ada spoke German fluently by now. So a whole host of information eluded her. And as a result, her husband almost always maintained the upper hand.
Amy hätte theoretisch die Möglichkeit gehabt, von Ada eine detaillierte Begründung für meine Entscheidung zu bekommen. Sie verspielte die Chance, indem sie sich mit dem Gedanken zufrieden gab, dass sie wegen ihrer neuen Lesebrille einfach besser die Herduhr lesen konnte als ihr Ehemann. Ohnehin redete Irmi sehr wenig mit Ada. Sie wusste nicht einmal, dass Ada inzwischen fließend Deutsch sprach. Somit entgingen ihr jede Menge Informationen und ihr Mann behielt darum fast immer die Oberhand.
This was not always so. In their first life together, Amy was the one who not only wore the pants, but the whole suit, including fedora and cane. It was not, for instance, he, but Amy who had met and negotiated with the Russians right after the unconditional capitulation of the Wehrmacht, right after Amy's husband appeared in the hallway, stuttering, gazing in all four cardinal directions, even right through Amy, but not looking her directly in the eyes. Right after both of the children, remember in the first allocation there was a son and a daughter, had found Amy's lipstick.
Das war mal anders. In ihrem ersten gemeinsamen Leben hatte Irmi nicht nur die Hosen an, sondern den ganzen Anzug, inklusive Fedora, Hut und Gehstock. Es war zum Beispiel nicht etwa er, sondern Irmi, die sich damals mit den Russen getroffen und verhandelt hatte. Gleich nach der bedingungslosen Kapitulation der Wehrmacht. gleich nachdem Irmis Mann stotternd im Hausflur erschien und in jede Himmelsrichtung schaute, sogar durch Irmi hindurch, nur nicht ihr direkt ins Gesicht. Gleich nachdem beide Kinder, in der ersten Verteilung gab es ja auch einen Sohn und eine Tochter, Irmis Lippenstift gefunden hatten.
Unfortunate. Oh, that was her favorite lipstick.
Favorite lipstick? That was her only lipstick.
Her only lipstick? Really unfortunate. Oh.
Ungünstig. Oh, das war ihr Lieblingslippenstift.
Lieblingslippenstift? Das war ihr einziger Lippenstift.
Ihr einziger Lippenstift? Wirklich sehr ungünstig. Oh.
Little Peter was already standing in the shame on the corner. He couldn't quite cross his little arms, so despite making a good effort at it, he looked more tortured than angry. The younger daughter grinned at her father with her lusciously painted lips and teeth, while Irmi scolded her husband mercilessly. The stairs are to be swept from the top down, she hissed at one point, then shoved a toddler-filled diaper into his arms. That same day, she got serious about demanding her first meeting with Sergei Pavlovich Korolyov, a sort of Russian Werner von Braun. In fact, each and every Grotrup survived the post-war years because they were brought to the Soviet Union by Korolyov himself. Nobody in the Grotrup household speaks of this anymore, yet on this day, I was Irmi's last lipstick. And I still vividly remember how much relief was felt when Irmi's husband learned that he wouldn't have to choose between his career in rocket engineering and his family, as more than a few of his colleagues had been forced to do. He had Irmi alone to thank for that, but he didn't know that anymore. Since the second great allocation, a remarkably high number of people of his sort fared that way.
Klein Peter stand bereits in der nun schändlichen Ecke. Seine kurzen Arme schaffte er nicht ganz ineinander zu verschränken, darum sah er, obwohl er sich alle Mühe gab, eher gequält als wütend aus. Das Töchterchen grinste den Vater mit fett bemalten Lippen und Zähnen an, während Irmi gnadenlos mit ihrem Mann schimpfte. Die Treppe fegt man von oben, zischte sie irgendwann und drückte gleichzeitig ihrem Mann eine Windel von einem Kleinkind in die Arme. Noch am selben Tag verlangte sie allen Ernstes ein Treffen mit Sergei Pavlovich Korolyov, eine Art russische Werner von Braun. Tatsächlich überlebten alle Grotrups die Jahre nach dem Krieg, weil sie von Korolyov höchstpersönlich in die Sowjetunion gebracht worden waren. Darüber wird heutzutage im Hause Grotrup mehr nicht mehr geredet. Doch an jenem Tag war ich Irmis letzter Lippenstift. Und ich erinnere mich noch genau, wie groß die Erleichterung war, als Irmis Mann erfuhr, dass er nicht zwischen Raketenbau und Familie wählen musste, wie manch einer seiner Kollegen. Das hatte er allein Irmi zu verdanken. Aber er wusste es nicht mehr. Seit der zweiten großen Verteilung geht es auffällig vielen Menschen seiner Art so.
Not becoming hardborn is no great feat for a German dick. It's quite a bit more difficult for me to stand the fact that you living beings communicate exclusively by means of this prison called language.
Als deutsches Ei nicht hart zu werden ist keine so große Leistung. Deutlich schwieriger ist es für mich auszuhalten, dass es ihr Lebenden ausschließlich mittels dieses Gefängnisses namens Sprache kommuniziert.
Languages and their categories. Oh,
humans and their categories.
They are not all there. Oh, they are not all there.
Sprachen und ihre Kategorien. Oh,
humans and their categories.
Sie sind nicht ganz dicht. Oh, sie sind nicht ganz dicht.
So whenever I become something written, I attempt, mostly in vain, to ignore all the content. And in your year 1862, I was busy as the epicenter of an earthquake in Accra. That was hard. I really had to pull myself together to not just stop after destroying those European fortresses, It wasn't supposed to look like the wrath of God, just, you know, like a so-called natural disaster.
Also immer, wenn ich etwas Schriftliches werde, versuche ich meist vergeblich, die Inhalte zu ignorieren. Und als ihr das Jahr 1862 geschrieben habt, war ich als Epizentrum eines Erdbebens in Accra unterwegs. Das war vielleicht schwer. Ich habe mich wirklich sehr zusammenreißen müssen, um nicht einfach bei der Zerstörung der europäischen Festungen zu bleiben. Es sollte ja nicht wie eine Strafe Gottes aussehen, sondern eher wie eine sogenannte Naturkatastrophe.
Same thing last week in Berlin, when Helmut Kohl was elected to Parliament for the fourth time. I would have been just too pleased to flip up suddenly so that he would have tripped, maybe even fallen, on his way to the podium on live television. That sight would have done me good. But this time was not meant to be. Or more honestly, I had been expressly forbidden to do so. One day though, I will again be an important red carpet. In exactly 20 years, another politician will be the victim of my disfavor. His name will be Robert Mugabe, barring any interference, and he will be in Harare. But I'm getting way ahead of myself.
Ähnlich ging es mir vergangene Woche in Berlin, als Helmut Kohl die deutsche Bundestagswahl zum vierten Mal gewann. Zu gerne wäre ich in einem strategischen Moment plötzlich hochgeklappt, so dass er auf dem Weg zum Podest hätte stolpern, eventuell auch hinfallen müssen, vor laufenden Fernsehkameras. Dieser Anblick hätte mir gut getan. Es sollte aber diesmal nicht sein, oder ehrlicher, es ist mir ausdrücklich verboten worden. Aber irgendwann einmal werde ich wieder ein wichtiger roter Teppich sein. In ziemlich genau 20 Jahren wird ein anderer Politiker Opfer meiner Ungnade sein. Er wird Robert Mugabe heißen, wenn nichts dazwischen kommt, und wir werden uns in Harare befinden. Aber ich greife zu weit vor.
We are at the crossroads. The third great allocation is coming up. Today is the day that it will dawn on Irmi and her husband. I've been hoping that I'll finally also get to be born today, but my plan with the eggness didn't quite pan out. Now that I've been so impatient and dogmatic with Irmi's husband, I already know it's highly unlikely this time around. I know because there are still no pictures.
Wir sind bei Grotrups. Die dritte große Verteilung steht bald an. Heute ist der Tag, an dem es Irmi und ihrem Mann bewusst werden wird. Ich habe gehofft, dass ich heute auch endlich geboren werden darf. Aber mein Plan mit dem Eisern ist nicht aufgegangen. Weil ich Irmis Mann gegenüber so ungeduldig und rechthaberisch gewesen bin, weiß ich jetzt schon, dass es bei dieser Runde wohl wieder nichts wird. Ich weiß es, weil es immer noch keine Bilder gibt.
That's the difference between the unborn and the deceased. Even if the deceased themselves aren't discernible in the images, drawings, or narratives, they are consoled by the fact that the life of their loved ones goes on. The dead have images. Those who have never lived are still in waiting.
Das ist der Unterschied zwischen den Ungeborenen und den Verstorbenen. Auch wenn Verstorbene selber nicht mehr auf Fotos, in Zeichnungen und durch Erzählungen wahrnehmbar sind, tröstet es sie zu wissen, dass das Leben der Liebsten weitergeht. Tote haben Bilder. Die, die noch nie gelebt haben, warten noch darauf. Please remove your right hand from your head. You may, if you like, hold the story with both hands now.
Nehmen Sie bitte Ihre rechte Hand vom Kopf weg. Sie können, wenn Sie möchten, nun die Geschichte mit beiden Händen festhalten.
But the idea that an egg might possibly have its own thoughts and preferences, Herr Grotrup could only shake his head involuntarily, What nonsense. He briefly contemplated reducing the idea to absurdity by fixating on it for a few seconds, after which he cleared his throat as if to start a one-sided conversation with the egg. But right then, Ilmi entered the dining room with his second egg. Without any further ado, the couple could have given the start of breakfast a second go, as though the first attempt hadn't happened, as though the clocks were just now striking 7:30. But Herr Grundtvig, with his no longer quite so pristine tie, could not stand the situation any longer. He excused himself, reassuring Ilmi while leaving the room that he would return shortly. And before Ilmi could even catch her breath, Herr Grundtvig was in the upstairs bathroom, the second big surprise of the day. A stranger was already standing there, sorting the laundry. He avoided her eyes. If he had looked even just for a second, he would have had to admit how strangely they all were to him.
Bei dem Gedanken, dass ein Ei möglicherweise eigene Ideen und Präferenzen haben könnte, musste Herr Grundtvig unfreiwillig den Kopf schütteln. Was für ein Unfug. Er überlegte kurz, den Gedanken ad absurdum zu führen, indem er es fixierte, einige Sekunden lang. Und sich anschließend räusperte, als würde er anfangen, einen einseitigen Dialog mit ihm zu führen. Doch just in dem Moment kam Irmi mit seinem zweiten Ei ins Esszimmer. Das Paar hätte kurzerhand noch einmal mit dem Frühstück anfangen können, als hätte es den ersten Anlauf gar nicht gegeben. Als würden die Glocken erst jetzt 7.30 Uhr schlagen. Jedoch hielt es Herr Grundtvig mit seiner nun nicht mehr ganz so makellosen Krawatte nicht mehr aus. Er entschuldigte sich bei Irmi und versicherte ihr, während er aus dem Zimmer schritt, dass er gleich wieder da sein würde. Und ehe Irmi wieder nach Luft schnappen konnte, war Herr Grundtvig schon oben im Badezimmer. Die zweite große Überraschung des Tages, eine Unbekannte stand bereits dort und sortierte die Wäsche. Er vermied ihre Augen, hätte er in sie geschaut, wenn auch nur flüchtig, hätte er nicht leugnen können, dass sie ihm seltsam vertraut vorkam. Man.
Who are
Wer bist
you?
Du? Stammelte Herr Grundtvig. Ich bin die Ada.
She answered as though there was nothing more normal in the world than her holding his underwear as they introduced themselves.
Sie antwortete, es gebe es nichts Selbstverständlicheres, als dass sie seine Unterhose in der Hand halten würde, wenn sie sich kennenlernten.
Ada, he responded. Beads of sweat appeared on his forehead.
Ada, erwiderte er. Schweißperlen formten sich auf seine Stirn.
Ada, I'm Doran Ilmegard's maid. So we're skipping the formalities? Sir, you started it.
Sie haben damit angefangen.
Fair enough. Herr Grundtvig now had multiple problems at once. To get himself out of this difficulty, he extended his hand. He'd actually been intending to introduce himself. Ada, though, took this as an inspection, as though he reached out his hand to examine his underwear. Had Herr Grundtvig just looked at Ada properly, as one ought to, he might have avoided shaking her hand with his undies between their fingers. But then again, maybe not.
Wohl wahr. Herr Grundtvig hatte nun mehrere Probleme gleichzeitig. Um sich zu helfen, gab er ihr die Hand. Er wollte sich eigentlich vorstellen. Ada hatte das allerdings als Kontrolle gedeutet, als wolle er seine Unterhose prüfen. Hätte Herr Grundtvig Ada vernünftig angeschaut, wie es sich gehört, wäre er nicht in die Situation gekommen, dass sie sich die Hände schüttelte mit seinem Schlüpfer zwischen den Fingern. Vielleicht aber doch.
All those who underestimate Ada regret it eventually.
Alle Menschen, die Ada unterschätzen, bereuen es irgendwann.
Back in the living room, he saw Ilmi sitting at the table, waiting for him. She didn't ask any questions, and this was a good thing.
Zurück im Wohnzimmer sah wie Ilmi am Tisch saß und auf ihn wartete. Sie stellte ihm keine Fragen, und das war ihm recht so.
Herr Grütrup sat down.
Herr Grütrup setzte sich hin.
And Ada started to clean the toilet in the bathroom upstairs.
Und Ada fing an, die Toilette im Obergeschoss zu putzen.
Oh wow. Thank you.
Yeah, I enjoyed it.
Let's talk about it. Who's got something to say? You want to take a breather?
Can I tell a little anecdote, just really briefly, and you'll know that I'm German as soon as I get to the end of it. Yesterday, I decided. So I have an egg boiler. And yesterday, I always take my boiled eggs to lunch with me. And yesterday, I decided to actually take them the way you described, the way Umi likes them, to lunch with me. So I changed the way I use the egg boiler. And so today, I tried those eggs for the first time. And I was thinking a lot about these eggs during the day, I guess, because now that you started that story, I was just sitting there and thinking, wow, oh goodness, so much of this sounds very familiar, even though it's happening in Tucson, but there's something so, I don't know, the whole egg business, I kept thinking about so many Sunday morning conversations with my parents about hard-boiled and soft-boiled eggs, and I see people nodding, and then you caught me completely off guard when the eggs started talking and narrating, and can you tell us more about these unusual narrators? Are we even allowed to know more about them, maybe?
Oh, the short answer would be no, wouldn't it? Well, partly it's difficult for me to answer the question because I wrote it a long time ago, actually, and the main point was to describe this married couple and how easy it was for them to be jolted out of their routine by something unusual happening. That was actually the main point, in a way. And then when I won the competition, I now have a really great opportunity to develop the story into a full-length novel. So now I have to come up with an answer to your question. And I'm thinking about it. It's something to do with different perspectives and people being set in their ways and whether they're able to allow for change and what would that feel like. Change feels unsettling and scary. That kind of thing I'm going to explore. Yeah.
I can't wait.
So I have a question about content, because I've heard it now in two languages, and I thought he called Ilmi Mutti because they had no children, but then there were children suddenly in the lipstick scene.
Yeah.
Can you tell me who the
kids are? So that has something to do with how it came to be that I was writing the story. When I first came up with the name Grütrup, I had Googled him and only found out about him and this woman. The Grütrups really did live back in Nazi Germany and so on. And so I started to write the story, and I've written this line. He calls her Mutti, even though they don't have children. And then I found out later through the Wikipedia article, if I'd read it earlier, I wouldn't have written that they did actually have children. And then I was a bit frustrated because I wanted to keep the line because I found the line so good. So then I came up with this concept of the Verteilung, which is something that
it's really difficult for me to describe the fatality because I haven't thought it through to the end, but roll with me. It's something like the idea that we all get a second and a third chance. So in the first fatailong, the cards we are dealt, let's say, the married couple did have children and then they lived through what has really happened. This story is however set in the second fatailong, and in that allocation they didn't get children. So that's why there's this discrepancy between the first and second. It's an artistic device.
Is there any reason why you make Gurtrip 78 years old? Was there any particular?
There is. What was the reason again? I had started to write it before I really did the maths. So he was born in 1916 and he died in 1981. He didn't make it to become that old actually. But the story is set in 1994. So that's partly to demonstrate really clearly that this is not about a biography of facts that actually happened. It's all a fantasy. So again, in the first fatailong, he died in 1981. In the second fatailong, he lives to see Helmut Kohl becoming the fourth Bundeskanzler. And we'll see what happens from there. I don't know yet.
I've been reading your story for quite some time now in two different classes. I've come up with all these ideas, and now I'm sort of completely thrown off by this night because all my ideas have changed now.
Okay.
But I'm wondering, I thought a lot about it, but what does Ada represent in the story, and for you at least? I have my idea, but
I would love to hear your idea before I answer, though.
Okay, well, my idea of Ada was that she was this idea of a cleanliness, you know, something different coming into the home and not only breaking up that routine, but symbolizing some sort of, you know, he represents this German man who's so proud of his heritage, and I understood Ada as a foreigner coming into the house without him knowing, her coming into Germany without him knowing that she was there, and the egg kind of was her being out of the
knowing.
Yeah,
which is a valid interpretation, and I agree with it. And then bearing in mind what I've said about the allocation or the fatailong, I was trying to play with the idea of the Grotrups having to be told, go back to go. No, they're playing Monopoly or whatever. They've got to go back to the start again because there's a lesson that they didn't learn, which is why they're about to go through it the third time. And the egg is a figure that I put in to show the reader that it's not my intention to put myself above the Grotrups. I'm not pointing my finger at them as such. And that's why the egg hasn't even made it to start the game yet. So the egg is a loser. And then Ada is actually a figure who's already made it through and is finished and waiting for everyone to catch up. Ada is a figure who has the most oversight of all. And Ada is something like an Achilles heel maybe in the Grotrup's life. If they took the time to notice her and look at her properly and speak to her properly, then they would find out what they needed to know, perhaps to get through the game. But yeah, for whatever reason, they choose not to do that. And I feel that that's kind of a statement about how I feel the debate on migration happens in Germany, or maybe even in German-speaking countries, that the people who are being discussed are rarely being addressed and talked with and asked for their expertise and their knowledge. And one final thing I wanted to add was when I write, I often show my work to people and get their feedback. I show it to many people, especially in German. I rely on people's feedback for their impression about language and imagery and so on, what it does to them. And one of the people I showed the story to is a Black Austrian woman, and she told me that she didn't like the end of the story because the last line is Ada fing an die Toilette im Obergeschoss zu putzen. She started to clean the toilet, and she found that an anticlimax. So I did think a lot about whether I could change that, and for a while I added the last word vermutlich, or what's vermutlich again?
Brave.
Apparently, something like that, to make it a bit more open. But actually, I decided to take that out and leave it as clear as it is. I'm usually more ambiguous about such things, but in this case, I felt I'd already given enough hints in the story that Ada is a figure we should take more seriously. And if people get to the end of the story and still only think of her as a toilet cleaner, then that's not my responsibility. I'm going to go for it. And I was thinking about people like this, the so-called guest workers, Gastarbeiter, that came and did all the dirty work. And I wanted to really pay homage to them in that last sentence. So that's why it's like that. Okay, there's a question. I might need help with picking people. I don't want to miss anyone. Okay.
Yesterday, there also was a question about Ada, and people had wondered a little bit in our discussion how to interpret her. I think we had sort of a little bit focus on how much she was in control of the story. And I was, at one point, was thinking, Ada, that sounds like you, as if you are hiding behind that. Yeah. And then the last remarks actually changed my own perspective a little bit more, because I felt like this, there's a process of cleaning, and whoever is cleaning is really taking charge of everyone else. Just like the man has to clean, has to learn how to sweep the staircase. He has to be told what to do. So it's a kind of reversal of all hierarchies. Those who are on top clean and clean the dirt down, and Gertrude's at the bottom, and the dirt sort of comes onto them in a way, down toilet.
Maybe we should write this together. Thank you. Anyway, I don't see myself as Ada, although I see, okay, this is a little bit complicated. I did originally write the story as a description of whiteness and white maleness and white femaleness, specifically German white maleness and femaleness. But my bigger point was more to talk about what it's like to be completely secure in your own identity and never have to question your surroundings. And although I don't have it with regards to race, and I don't have it with regards to gender, I do have it with regards to sexuality or nationality or so on. So I never feel really threatened in my identity as a British woman walking through Germany. And there are people who don't have a British passport or a European passport when they see police in the area, then they do feel really anxious. So I wanted to describe this feeling of being secure, everything being measured, and you know, you can see how it's going to follow through from one step to the next logically. That's the figure that's now Herr Grotrup, and then the figure Frau Grotrup experiences some kind of marginalization, therefore is more flexible. Doesn't matter if the egg boils 7 minutes or not, doesn't matter if the egg isn't the way she likes it or not. But even Frau Grotrup underestimates the figure of Ada. So I just wanted to show these different kinds of intersectionalities. And I consider myself to be, actually, to be honest, more of a Herr Grotrup. I like the Regionalbahn pünktlich und so. That's me.
So, as a translator, I'd like to congratulate the translators. About your experience in the translation process.
Yeah.
And I love to think, as a Vertilung in translation, where the translator can be, is, or see himself. Because that's how I feel when I've had to translate. It's Vertilung, and I have to do something.
Okay. Well, I think the business of translation is something like working miracles. I have to say that. I've decided I will never translate again, because I'm just not very good at it. And it's interesting, people often have, when I first won the prize, everything, all the press information was in German, of course, and my family back in London were like, oh, well done, Sharon, what's she done? What happened? I was hoping upon hope that somebody would write an article in The Guardian. It finally appeared, and something appeared in English in Deutsche Welle, but they still didn't know what was going on in this story. And especially my brother and sister are both monolingual, and I remember once my brother said to me, what's so difficult about translation? You just get out a dictionary and you put one that... And I was like, no, it doesn't work that way. So they both didn't, they thought I was being a bit mean when I said I wasn't going to translate it. But it was really important to me that there was an English version. And then I got this tweet, hey Sharon, is there an English version of your story? And if not, can we do it? And I was like, yeah, that was so exciting. And now I've got a conversation going on. Somebody has asked me, what do I think of the translation? Is it written in the way that I would have written the story if I'd written the story in English? And I said, I wouldn't have written the story in English. You understand what I mean? It's, for me, it's an impossible story to write in English. I came to the story with an image of this guy, and I don't know how I would express the duzen and siezen and this kind of thing. Duzen is the informal way of addressing, and siezen is the formal way of addressing, which doesn't... Actually, I think it does exist a bit in the US because we have the ma'am and the sir, which we don't have in the UK so much, but anyway, that's an aside. I wouldn't have known how to do it. I made some very specific cultural references that I think Germans get straight away. I think if I was writing a story which I wanted to convey whiteness in England, I would have chosen a completely different married couple or a completely different challenge, not the egg. I don't know what I would have chosen. So when David told me that Judith and Patrick were prepared to take on this challenge, I was totally, totally grateful. And I think they did a brilliant job.
Did you interact with them as they were translating? Because when I asked my question, it wasn't so much about the product, but maybe the process, if there had been one.
I would very much like to welcome you to the stage to talk about the process. Please.
First question, was there interaction during the process?
Yes, there was. There was a Google Doc.
Wow.
Which should be probably an article in itself at this point.
Absolutely.
But we translated it first before we sent it. So yeah. It wasn't somebody put in a word and another person put in a word. It was done and then we talked about it with comments.
We actually allocated the text. So my part was the first half. And we were working together. There was communication between the two of us, which you of course need because it has to.
How long have the three of you been collaborating? Like Sharon, were you involved from the very beginning in the translation, or did you?
I came to be involved once the first draft was written.
Yeah, September sounds good.
Okay.
let's say September.
So, I didn't want, for me, translation is an act of interpretation, which is another reason why I didn't want to do it myself, because I'd written the text and in parts it's deliberately ambiguous, and if I had translated it myself, I would have fixed it down a little bit more, and I didn't want to do that. And I had said, I think, to the three of you very early on, this is your translation. You know, I'll give you my feedback and I'll tell you, well, I think this might sound more, or if there's really a misunderstanding, I will point that out. But apart from that, I'm really happy for you to make up the story what you will.
How was that experience? How did you experience that position in the particular, which is a particular one, not all translated authors?
Yeah,
decide on that.
Well, first of all, it's always a great honor to actually get to work with the author, because many of them just like stonewall, they don't have anything to do with that. So that's always great. And of course, you have that in the back of your mind. You're just like, okay, what's she got to say? What's she got to think of this? But like in general, it was very challenging, definitely. And that was, I would say, mostly because of the cultural references. Like, how do you translate Bakri Bakri? And then you do the research and you look it up and you say, oh, there's actually a British company that makes these things. And for everybody who doesn't know what that is, it's like a little like dog figurine of like a Dachshund that a lot of, some Germans put in the back of their cars and that kind of nods along as you're driving.
Bobblehead.
Yeah, something like that.
It's not a bobblehead. It's
yeah, it is still different. Yeah, and then but it has become like this pop cultural icon. It was a huge deal in the 90s, I think. Along with like the fedora hats in the back of the car, so it just goes on and on down that hole, and that's just one word. And then of course this is just one of the let's say less subtle things. There's a lot of like undertones that you really need to try to get, and also make them universally accessible.
I guess we should also mention that we translated into American English. And then the first comments were differences between British and American English. So something like one of the, in the beginning, I think, or maybe half of here, I'm not exactly sure where it is, but there's Punkt in German, which is period in American English, but full stop in British English. And when I first got that comment, I was like, I didn't know what that was. So there was some things like that too that were, that just kind of came up in the process.
May I add something real quick? Also an answer to Marlene's question, which is, Sharon was kind to allow me to share the English translation with one of my classes. And as I was taking the translation that Judith and Patrick had done, and I saw all the kind of comments in the column, you know how you add comments into a Word document and there's these bubbles where it's a conversation between various writers and people, and it's in this construction process. And first of all, my hunch was, oh, I'm supposed to erase all those things before I give this text as a kind of unified, stable thing to my students who are kind of outsiders to the process. And then I thought to myself, why would I ever do that? You know, why not actually share with our students the kinds of conversations that go on between author and translator? I mean, I was careful to choose things that, you know, were to check with them and to look at it. But it was really interesting to consider some of those conversations between author and translator and editors as part of the text itself, or part of this kind of process, which isn't just a product, but is also a set of relations, you know, a set of, you know, relationships and friendships and trust and hope and all of those things. And so keeping some of those margin comments there and allowing that to be something that our students also got a chance to read was really, it was wonderful, but it was also a way of entrusting the process to others to kind of engage with as well. So that's what I mean.
It makes the prison a little more livable.
And we're still translating a little bit. So yesterday we were talking about the text, and there was one particular word that we all started talking about, rechthaberisch, which I translated as dogmatic, and now I'm unhappy with it. But I don't have a solution.
Self-righteous.
Yeah, I've thought about that too, but I'm not happy with that either.
So now I have a very fickle translator or boiled egg translator question. You spoke of kilograms and then feet.
Yes.
Was that the combination of decision and how, why?
Yeah, it is, I guess, a matter of accessibility and because this is a passage where you don't even get that, like, you don't get the exact height of a protagonist or something. And you're creating a mental image in that moment, and then you kind of have to make a decision, okay, how do I want to create this, because you're really setting up this image for the rest of the story. Honestly, I can't quite remember right now why I chose one over the other. I think it was a bit of foreignizing, I guess, right, to some extent, to also make like an American audience be like, wait, how much is a meter in 1978? Let me look this up, or let me not look this up, I don't care. Or the kilograms or whatever it was. Yeah. Awesome.
I wanted to say something about that. So when I wrote it, I wrote 1.83 meters, and I wanted 1.83 meters to sound so completely measured to the millimeter, right? And then when the translation first came back, it was 6 feet tall. And I'm like, how boring is that? And then I was like, is it true? And I briefly considered changing the German so that, you know, and then I suggested putting exactly in that, exactly 6 feet tall. So that's one of those things that happened.
Thank you.
Should we take one more question? Is
the interpretation that when hearing you read it really strongly evoke feelings of childhood and hearing the text, and I don't know if that's intentional or not, but the fact that birth kind of like intrudes upon life and kind of makes like Kleinigkeiten out of the little rules and everything, it really struck me constantly throughout the whole thing, especially at the end where if he had just looked Ada in the eyes, really strongly evoked like seeing your child. And it's just a really strong impression.
Before we close out, I just want to, the experience of being together doing this, it had never occurred to me that at some point during our meeting that I was going to think about whether I was supposed to be speaking to you as well, and whether I was even supposed to be looking over.
Yeah.
You know, that was so for us, there's also a process of becoming to. I would like to thank everybody for starting off their week with us, and our co-sponsors, Department of German Studies, Program in Africana Studies, Department of French and Italian. I'd like to thank our translators, Judith Menzel and Patrick Poshinsky, and Sharon Dodo too, for coming so far to be with us and to share a Monday evening with us. I am going to adjourn to that table with books. So if anybody would like to buy a book, I will be there. I'm cash poor, but I will try to do as best as I can with change, $10 to $50 sliding scale. And then please feel free to come chat with Sharon Dodo too a little bit more. And it's really, really wonderful that you all were able to come out for this evening. So thanks, everyone.